Obviously, as a node ingests a lot of data, it's going to generate several SS tables. And as new records come in to replace the old records, we're going to have a lot of data that's no longer necessary or stale. Apache Cassandra uses a process called compaction, which removes all of the stale data from the pre-existing SS tables. Here's one SS table. You see, we have a bloom filter, a key cache, partition summary, partition index, SS table. All of these SS tables have all these groupings of data structures for every single individual one. Compaction is the process of combining all of these SS tables into one SS table. Let's first look at how Apache Cassandra compacts two individual partitions from two SS tables together. You'll notice the partition on the left has keys of 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. The partition on the right has 1, 2, 3, no 4, 5, and 6. We have the timestamps of each individual value to the right, which we've wrapped in parentheses. Apache Cassandra stores a timestamp with every single value in every single cell so that Apache Cassandra can keep track of which value is the latest and greatest data. Notice all the rows in the partition on the left have earlier timestamps than any of the rows in the partition on the right. That's because the partition on the left was an SS table written before the SS table on the right. That's just something to be aware of as we compact these two partitions together. So for example, we have Johnny at the top there with a timestamp of 92. The corresponding value with the SS table on the right is also Johnny, keyed off of the 1, with a timestamp of 181. Since 181 is greater than 92, the Johnny on the right is the newest value. When you do a read and you actually read from this table, Apache Cassandra will return the value on the right in this case because it has a later timestamp than the Johnny on the left. Let's look at record number 2. Betsy on the left, and then it looks like an X, but it's actually a tombstone. It's a marker for a deletion. Whenever you delete, Apache Cassandra actually writes a new value, and that new value we call a tombstone. It basically says, yo, this record is dead to me. Notice the tombstone on the right has a later timestamp than the Betsy value on the left. 176 is greater than the value of 49. Now this is where things get a little tricky. There's a value inside of the Cassandra YAML file called GC grayseconds. It defaults to 10 days. If a tombstone is older than 10 days by default, the tombstone is evicted. If the tombstone is less than 10 days old, we actually keep it around to prevent resurrection of data if there happens to be a repair. We cover that in a different section. In this case, our tombstone is older than the 10-day period. So Apache Cassandra removes the tombstone, but also the old value of Betsy from the SS table on the left. You see row 3 has Nikolai on the left. For some reason, Nikolai wanted to change his name to Norman later on the right. So Nikolai on the left with a value of 85, that timestamp is less than the 148 on the right. So when Cassandra reads from these two files, Cassandra will return the value of Norman on the right because it has a later timestamp than the value of Nikolai on the left. However, we need to get rid of the old stale data. Next record is Sue. Notice Sue likes her name. She stays with it. She doesn't update it, so we don't have a corresponding record in the SS table on the right. So compacting that value is simple. Just copy it into the new SS table file. Here's Sam. He's located in the SS table on the left and also has a tombstone on the right. This particular tombstone is less than GC grayseconds, which means it needs to stick around until it's more than 10 days old. So Apache Cassandra writes that tombstone into the new SS table file. Our last value, Henry. This is actually the original insert of Henry. Henry didn't exist in the SS table on the left. So compacting Henry's value is simple. Put it into the new SS table file and delete the old SS tables. They're no longer necessary because we now have this new SS table with all the relevant values inside of it. Now that we've looked at how to combine two partitions together, let's look at how we combine two SS table files together. Remember, an SS table is just full of those partitions that we need to combine. So let's look at an example. SS table on the top has partitions with key 7, 13, 18, so on and so forth. SS table on the bottom has partitions with key 3, 7, 18, so on and so forth as well. We need to combine both of these SS tables into a new SS table. Remember, SS tables are immutable. We don't change them up. We just read from existing SS tables, create a new SS table with all the recent values, and then delete the old SS tables. Here's our new SS table. Remember, Apache Cassandra stores the partitions inside of the SS table file sorted by partition token value. We'll start with partition token with value 3. Cassandra copies the values into the new SS table, and we're done, we're good. Let's take partition 7 from both SS tables. We need to combine all these values together. Watch what happens. We actually shrink. I bet you were expecting for that to grow because both of those partitions were rather large. Maybe I caught you off guard with that one. Partition 3 didn't shrink, and then we had two partitions of 7 come in and it actually got smaller than the partition 3. I want you to pause the video here and think, what's Jamie up to here? And then come back and let's talk about it. If you remember on the previous example, we compacted the actual cell values together. In this case, partition 3 didn't have any stale data. It all had to stick around. Whereas the partition 7 from both SS tables, we had to combine all those, and it turns out there was a lot of stale and tombstone data in both of those partitions. That's why 7 got smaller. The important key fact to note here is we only have the values inside of our partitions that are still relevant, that are still up to date. The rest of it's all gone, and this new SS table is actually going to be smaller than the previous two SS tables, which you would expect if there's a lot of stale data. Partition 13 is next. It's actually full of tombstones, so a lot of those go away because those tombstones are past the GC grace seconds period. Here comes our 18s. They shrink as well. Again, a lot of stale data. Partition 21 comes in. There haven't been any updates or deletes in partition 21, so it actually stays the same. Partition 36 comes in. It actually shrinks because it has stale tombstones. 58 comes in. The overall new size of partition 58 is smaller than the two partitions combined, but it's still larger than either one of them because not all the data was stale. Here's partition 84. It's actually full of expired tombstones. Let's compact it out and get it out of there. So now we have a new SS table. We can delete the old SS tables, reclaim that disk space for future writes, and we're good to go. Having fewer SS tables also optimizes reads because we don't need to read through and retrieve a bunch of stale data and then coalesce it with the newer values. Now I've shown you how Apache Cassandra combines two SS tables together, but on disk you'll have several SS tables that need to be compacted. It would be a bad idea to take all those SS tables and combine them together in one epic compaction. That would bog your node down something serious. So instead, what Apache Cassandra does is it chooses which SS tables need to be combined with other SS tables. That is your compaction strategy. There's three main compaction strategies to consider. The default is size-tiered compaction, which basically takes multiple SS tables of the same size and combines them together. It's great if you're ingesting a lot of data, or we call that a write-heavy workload. If you have a read-heavy workload with several reads going on, many more than writes, you'll want to consider using leveled compaction, which optimizes for that situation. If you're ingesting time series data, where the data comes in sequentially by time, then consider time-windowed compaction. We cover all these compaction strategies in depth in another course. Okay, that was a mouthful, especially for me. Let's go do an exercise on compaction.